بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونسترضيه ونستبينه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا، إنه من يهد الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلن تجد له وليا مرشدا. Dear brothers and sisters everywhere, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Today inshallah we're gonna resume our reflections on سورة المؤمنون, the faithful ones or the believers. And in the last few weeks we have seen Prophet Nuh sallallahu alayhi wasallam, while he has been rejected by his people on the pretext that he was a human being, and many other prophets and messengers who were sent by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to guide humanity or to guide their peoples to the right path, they were rejected on the pretext that they were human beings. And today inshallah Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala relates to us, or the surah relates to us, it goes on to look at other generations and communities. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, ثُمَّ أَنْشَأْنَا مِنْ بَعْدِهِمْ قُرُونًا آخَرِينَ. Then after them we created other generations. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, after the people of Nuh, he created other nations and other peoples, such as the people of Salih, the people of Lut, and the people of Shu'aib, and others. Then the surah goes on as saying, مَا تَسْبِقُ مِنْ أُمَّةٍ أَجَلَهَا وَمَا يَسْتَأْخِرُونَ. This is the law of Allah on earth. This is the law of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this whole universe. No nation can advance their term, nor can they delay it. Each and every nation, each and every generation, each and every people, they have their appointed term. They are created by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they are given a specific lifespan and appointed time, and when that appointed time comes to its end, they are gone, and others will replace them. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, مَا تَسْبِقُ مِنْ أُمَّةٍ أَجَلَهَا وَمَا يَسْتَأْخِرُونَ. No nation can advance their term, nor can they delay it. So every generation, every nation, every generation and nation, they get their term and they depart. And they are taken by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at the appropriate time, as decreed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the book that is preserved with him before they were created. Nation after nation, century after century, generation after generation, and successors after predecessors. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shows us a great fact and a solid fact, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent so many prophets and messengers to guide humanity, to guide their nations to the right path, and to show them the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَمَا مِنْ أُمَّةٍ إِلَّا خَلَى فِيهَا نَذِيرٌ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala never left a nation or a generation without sending a prophet or a messenger, a warner to them, to warn them of the severe punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and to guide them to the right path, to show them the way of Allah, and whom to worship and how to worship him. Whom to worship? The only one who deserves to be worshipped, the sole deity who deserves to be worshipped, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and how to worship him according to his law, according to his sharia, according to his legislation. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, ثُمَّ أَرْسَلْنَا رُسُولَنَا تَتْرَى. Then we sent our messengers in succession, following one another in succession. And this is like Allah saying in the Quran, وَلَقَدْ بَعَثْنَا فِي كُلِّ أُمَّةٍ رَسُولًا. And verily we have sent among every ummah a messenger, proclaiming, أَنْ اعْبُدُوا اللَّهَ وَاجْتَنِبُوا الطَّاغُوتَ. Worship Allah and avoid طاغوت. And الطاغوت here stands for all false deities, all false gods that are taken as gods beside Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فَمِنْهُمْ مَنْ هَدَى اللَّهُ وَمِنْهُمْ مَنْ حَقَّتْ عَلَيْهِ الضَّلَالَةُ. Then of them were some whom Allah guided, and of them were some upon whom the straying was justified. ثُمَّ أَرْسَلْنَا رُسُلَنَا تَتْرَى كُلَّمَا جَاءَ أُمَّةً رَسُولُهَا كَذَّبُوهُ. Every time there came to a nation their messenger, they denied him. Every community denies the truth given to them through Allah's messenger. And here, this doesn't mean that everyone in that nation or in that generation belied or denied the messenger, but the greater majority of them, the greater majority of those people, they deny the messengers and they deny their prophethood and their messengership. كلما جاء أمة رسولها كذبوه فأتبعنا بعضهم بعضا. So we made them follow one another. We destroyed them. Each time they do this, they are punished according to Allah's law, according to the Sunan of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this universe, that mercy is prescribed for the obedient ones and punishment and penalty is prescribed for the disobedient ones. فَأَتْبَعْنَا بَعْضَهُمْ بَعْضًا وَجَعَلْنَاهُمْ أَحَادِيثِ And we made them as ahadith, and we made them as ahadith, and ahadith here stands for stories and lessons for mankind. Stories and lessons for mankind. And the lesson remains there for anyone who wishes to learn. وَجَعَلْنَاهُمْ أَحَادِيثِ Told by one generation to the next. And here, subhanAllah, the word ahadith, it stands for tales and stories for people to tell and relate. And the Imam An-Nasafi in his great Tafsir An-Nasafi says, tales to be heard and be amazed at. And by the way, the word ahadith or the Arabic term ahadith can be the plural form of hadith. And the hadith is the statements and the narrations of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. As you all know, those ahadith, those thousands and thousands of ahadith that are compiled in Sahih Muslim, Sahih al-Bukhari, and the books of al-Sunan, as you all know. And also the word ahadith can be the plural form of uhdutha, and uhdutha stands for what people relate to amuse others and make them astonished or amazed. And this latter meaning is what is meant here, and Allah knows best. وَجَعَلْنَاهُمْ أَحَادِيثَ فَبُعْدًا لِقَوْمٍ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ فَبُعْدًا لِقَوْمٍ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ So away with the people who believe not. And this brief summary concludes with an emphatic rejection of such communities. The communities that disbelieved in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the communities that belied his messengers, and the ayah shows that they are cast away, and the cast away here, it means that they were destroyed and they were perished by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They are cast away from the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that mercy of Allah is prepared for the believing men and women from all communities, past and present. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us or relates to the story of Prophet Musa sallallahu alayhi wasallam and Prophet Harun with Fir'aun. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, ثم أرسلنا موسى وأخاه هارون بآياتنا وسلطان مبين. Then we sent Musa and his brother Harun with our ayat, with our miracles, with our signs and manifest authority. بآياتنا وسلطان مبين. So Allah here tells us about the story of Prophet Musa sallallahu alaihi wasallam and Prophet Harun when he sent them to Pharaoh and his chiefs and his people with decisive evidence and definitive proof. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala supported Prophet Musa sallallahu alaihi wasallam with nine miracles. And they are very, very famous. I'm going to just relate them. I'm going to just cite them all, all the nine signs, but I'm gonna just focus on only one of them, because this one is might need some explanation. So the nine signs that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, with which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala supported Prophet Musa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and Prophet Harun, were: the first one was The staff, which turned into a serpent. The staff, العصا, which turned into a serpent. The second one was Prophet Musa's hand when it became bright white. And the third sign is Pharaoh and his people when they saw the years of drought and shortage of crops. And the fourth one, and this is the one I need to focus on a little bit today, which is Prophet Musa sallallahu alaihi wasallam was fearless. He was fearless of Pharaoh, and Pharaoh was rendered powerless to harm him. And this is a miracle, subhanallah, and I'm going to explain this. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Al-Qasas, verse number 32, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells Prophet Musa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to do two things. The first thing is to place his hand in his pocket, then draw it out, and it becomes white. And this is, you know, this is the sign number two that we have just mentioned. And the second thing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told Prophet Musa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to do is that to draw his hands by his side, to ward off fear. And to understand this, Prophet Musa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he declared his fear of Pharaoh by saying, he said, "My Lord, I killed a person from amongst them, and so I fear that they may kill me." So how can Prophet Musa sallallahu alaihi wasallam ward off fear by simply drawing his hands to his side? That was Allah's design. And that was a sign from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But you know, whenever he felt fear of Pharaoh, by simply doing that, that would render Moses fears of Prophet Musa sallallahu alaihi wasallam fearless. Prophet Musa sallallahu alaihi wasallam was a messenger of Allah that was sent to challenge Pharaoh, and it was necessary for him that he wouldn't be shaking with fear whenever he faces Pharaoh, in order for him to be able to speak and to act with resolution and authority. And this would indicate that he was supported by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells Prophet Musa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the Quran, "We will strengthen your arm with your brother, and we will grant the two of you authority. And so they will not be able to get to you. They will not be able to get to you by virtue of our signs. بآياتنا, by virtue of our signs, the two of you and those who followed you will be the victors." So here, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says بآياتنا, by virtue of our signs, here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala confirms that Pharaoh was rendered in a miraculous way, in a miraculous manner. He was rendered powerless to touch or harm Prophet Musa and Prophet Harun. And that was, or in that, there was an awesome sign for Pharaoh and his people. And we know from the Quranic narrative that Pharaoh was a tyrant. He was a tyrant. He was a nasty piece of work. And we understand that. We understand that when he cut off the hands and the legs and crossed of the magicians who obeyed him in the morning, but they disobeyed him in the afternoon when they followed Prophet Musa sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when they saw the truth and when they understood and realized that what Prophet Musa sallallahu alaihi wasallam brought with him wasn't magic, but it was a real miracle from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that no magician or no sorcerer could have ever done something like what he did. That's why they became believers in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they admitted that even in front of Pharaoh and of everyone, the huge gatherings that Pharaoh gathered from all over Egypt to witness the defeat of Prophet Musa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam on that day. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala turned his beguile on him. And he was the one who was defeated, he and his sorcerers or magicians, and that rendered them all believers in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we saw the the brutal way in which Pharaoh butchered and crucified and cut off the limbs and the hands and the legs of those magicians when they disobeyed him and obeyed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and Prophet Musa. So Pharaoh was a nasty piece of work. But the question here, or the question that begs answering here, is that why did he never harm Musa sallallahu alayhi wasallam and the Prophet Harun, though both of them were in fact the cause of all his trouble? And the reason is now clear in the Quran. The reason is that he was physically unable to do so. He was physically unable to get to them or harm them, and that was an awesome sign for Pharaoh and for his people. And subhanallah, if Pharaoh had his way, he would have surely killed Prophet Musa sallallahu alaihi wasallam and Harun at the very first occasion, but he couldn't do that because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala prevented him from doing that. And through giving that sign to Prophet Musa sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that whenever he meets with Pharaoh, whenever he starts to fear him or to feel fear from him, all he has to do is to draw his hands by his side, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give him determination and resolution and will make him or render him fearless of Pharaoh and his troops and his people. Subhanallah Rabbil Alameen. So we have mentioned in relation to the signs, the nine signs that were given to Prophet Musa sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We have just mentioned the staff turning into a serpent, and we mentioned the his hand becoming bright white, and the years of drought and shortage of crops, and that Prophet Musa sallallahu alaihi wasallam becomes fearless, and Pharaoh was rendered powerless to harm him. As for the remaining five signs or miracles, they were the flood, the locusts, the lice, the frogs, and the blood. Subhanallah Rabbil Alameen.
ثم أرسلنا موسى وأخاه هارون بآياتنا وسلطان مبين إلى فرعون وملئه فاستكبروا وكانوا قوما عالين.
To Pharaoh, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent Prophet Musa and Prophet Harun to Pharaoh and his people, to Fir'aun and his chiefs, but they behaved insolently, and they were people self-exalted by disobeying their Lord. They, Fir'aun or Pharaoh and his people, they were too arrogant to follow Prophet Musa sallallahu alaihi wasallam and Prophet Harun and to obey their commands. And they said, Pharaoh and his people, they said,
فَقَالُوا أَنُؤْمِنُ لِبَشَرَيْنِ مِثْلِنَا وَقَوْمُهُمَا لَنَا عَابِدُونَ.
They said, shall we believe in two men like ourselves, and their people are obedient to us with humility? So here, Pharaoh or Pharaoh and his people, they disobeyed. They disobeyed Prophet Musa sallallahu alaihi wasallam and Prophet Harun, and they disbelieved in Musa and Harun because they were human beings. Again, the same pretext, the same argument is repeated here, and again in this account, we know that the same objection is given to the fact that the messenger was merely a human being, and this is just as the previous nations had denied the message of the human messengers. So those people, the people of Pharaoh and his people, they were of the same or of similar mentality as the previous nations and previous people who came before them. And that was the same notorious mindset. But here, subhanAllah, in this ayah, because the Quran is very, very precise, as you all know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says,
فَقَالُوا أَنُؤْمِنُ لِبَشَرَيْنِ مِثْلِنَا وَقَوْمُهُمَا لَنَا عَابِدُونَ.
So here there is a specific consideration that is connected with the Israelites situation in Egypt, which is even though their people are our slaves, وَقَوْمُهُمَا أَي بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلَ, the people of the children of Israel, the children of Israel, they were enslaved by the Egyptians. They were the descendants of Prophet Yaqub sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and they came to Egypt from the land of Canaan during the lifetime of Prophet Yusuf sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when Prophet Yusuf sallallahu alayhi wa sallam invited his father Prophet Yaqub and all his descendants, and they were about 76 or 67 persons, men and women and children. He invited them all to reside in Egypt, and the king of Egypt back then at that time, he gave them a piece of land that was near to Fayyum in Egypt, and they stayed there. But after the death of Prophet Yusuf sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and after the Hyksos were driven out of Egypt by the Egyptians, and the Pharaoh and the Pharaohs regained authority over Egypt again, they enslaved the children of Israel. They enslaved the descendants of Prophet Yaqub sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So here Pharaoh says, فقالوا, Pharaoh and his chiefs, فقالوا أنؤمن لبشرين مثلنا وقومهما لنا عابدون, even though their people are our slaves. So they are subservient to us, and they do our bidding. And in this situation, Prophet Musa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the Harun, they deserve in Pharaoh's and his people's view to be looked down upon. But what about the revelation? What about the revelation with which Prophet Musa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came or brought with him? And what about the signs, the nine signs that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave to Prophet Musa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to support him and to prove that he was a real and an authentic messenger that was sent by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? So as for the revelations and the signs that were given by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to Prophet Musa and Prophet Harun, and the clear authority that was granted to them, these count for nothing. These count for nothing according to these people, the people of Pharaoh and his people, because they were focused on the worldly or earthly considerations and false values. So these things were nothing to them. They constituted zero value to them. فكذبوهما فكانوا من المهلكين. So they denied them, Pharaoh and his chiefs and his people. They denied Prophet Musa sallallahu alayhi wasallam and Prophet Harun. They denied both of them, and thus became of those who were destroyed. They entailed and they deserved to be destroyed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because of their rejection of the prophets, because of their denial of the truth, and because of their challenge of Prophet Musa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and Prophet Harun, and challenge the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala destroyed Pharaoh and his people. He drowned them all in the sea in one day. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or the Quran, concludes this story, this account of Prophet Musa and Harun and Pharaon by saying, وَلَقَدْ آتَيْنَا مُوسَى الْكِتَابَ لَعَلَّهُمْ يَهْتَدُونَ. And indeed we gave Musa the scripture, the Torah, the scripture, that they may be guided. So after Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala destroyed Fir'aun and the Egyptians and seized them with a severe punishment, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed the book to Musa. He revealed the Torah to Prophet Musa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And in the Torah there were rulings and commands and prohibitions, and subhanallah, and each and every one of us can see this. After Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed the Torah, Allah didn't destroy any nation with an overwhelming calamity. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't destroy any nation with an overwhelming calamity. but instead he commanded the believers to fight the disbelievers. So, and this is very, very remarkable. And by the, you know, the last time Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent his obvious soldiers to protect the sacred sanctuaries of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent the flocks of birds at-tayr al-ababil against Abraha and his army when they tried to destroy the Kaaba. And by the birth of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the protection of Allah's sanctuaries were transferred from Jundullah التي لا يعلمها إلا هو, the soldiers of Allah who are known only to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to the believers, to Muslims. So by the birth of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the protection of the sanctuaries of Allah has been transferred to Muslims, to the believers, to the monotheistic believers in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But the question here is, are we doing our job properly? Are we doing our job properly? So here, dear brothers and sisters, we came to the end of our episode for today. And inshallah, next week we're gonna start with the ayah number 50, in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala relates to us some part of the story of Prophet Isa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Jesus Christ, and his mother Sayyida Maryam alayha as-salam wa alayhi as-salatu was-salam. So until then, assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.